Alright, it's that time again for another Friday Foursome. Yes, by Novabug, of course. And this is another really good topic, although it has the potential to make some of us very aggravated, and I'm thinking that's probably going to happen to me with some of these. It's just the way it is. But anyway, so this one is number 10, Most Irritating Aspects of Gaming. Yes, and like some of the other topics, this one was kind of hard to limit only down to 4 as well. In fact, the first one I immediately knew what to go with, because I've actually done a video on it specifically on its own in the past, still up to, and I still stand by what I said in that, because it's the truth, and I'm going to stand by it when I bring it up again here. It's actually the first one I'm going to talk about. But anyway, of course, as always, I'll have a link down in the description below so you can check his channel out if you haven't already, as well as his original video for this if you want to do a response yourself, which, why not? The more the merrier. Anyway, so let's get this started. Okay, so my first one, which technically is 2-in-1, so maybe they could count as separate ones, but they're so similar, I'm going to rope them in together, which is unskippable tutorials, and like I said, I'm throwing another one, unskippable cutscenes in. Now, I've said for years and years and years, and I still maintain this, it's unreasonable and not really that hard to expect or give us some way or option to skip tutorials as well as cutscenes. And in the case of cutscenes, a lot of games won't let you do it ever, or you have to see them the first time before you can. That's okay if it lets you do it eventually, but it should give you the option if you want to anyway. It makes replaying a game very annoying. But worse is tutorials. I don't have a problem with putting tutorials in a game. Quite a lot of them could use it, and well-made ones at that to help explain some of the mechanics in the games. But it's so many times you are forced into tutorials in many games, and there's quite a lot that still do this. It's been a while since I've run across many lately that do this. I mean, for example, the new Mad Max game, which I've been playing a lot. That one has a tutorial that you can't really avoid that happens in the beginning, but it blends itself into the game as what's going on at the time. So it's not really that annoying, and you do know it's there, but it's not very intrusive, and it's not just, all right, we got to stop everything. You can't have any fun until you do this. That's actually one other part I'm getting to, but anyway. A lot of games out there will not let you bypass a tutorial, no matter what you do. And it seems like sometimes it's like, you have the audacity to want to replay this game, well, you're going to have to sit through this tutorial again and be bored out of your skull before you can actually do what you want to do. Or, heaven forbid, you actually accidentally delete your damn save and you got to start all over again. That's even more fun. I'm not going to go on forever and give many examples, because I'm sure you can think of plenty. I know I'm not the only one that hates this. But there's one in particular I'll give an example so you can get an idea for the why I get frustrated with this stuff. Say, for example, strategy games, RTSs. Now, of course, you want to play those against real people, all that. Yeah. But if whether you do want to play the campaign, you could use any of these, but say the Age of Empires games or Empire Earth games. And if you do want to do the campaigns, the single-player campaigns, get some story and all that, the first few, or at least the first one for whatever faction you're going with, always is a tutorial. And you can't skip that one to get to the ones that don't lead you by the nose and force you what to do. Collect 10 wood for this, do this, do that. And it doesn't even let you off the rein so you can actually, you know, have fun with the game and play it the way you'd want to, or the game, you know, what they were intended you to do. Have fun with the damn thing because they made this tutorial. And no matter what you do, you can't bypass it. You have to do it. You have to do it. It's just as bad as kind of like in Gran Turismo where you got to do the license test if you want to do certain other races. I know it's not a tutorial, but it might as well be because it locks off part of the game. This is my point, is you can't get many of these games to do this. You cannot get to the actual meat of the game until you suffer through the tutorial. And again, it's even worse if you decide to replay the game because you can't skip it. Now, like I said, the good thing is there are quite a lot of games out there as well that do let you skip it, but there's far too many that don't. And again, like I said, the tutorial, the ones that these are forced, they're always very slow, very boring, monotonous. This is one thing I will kind of give Call of Duty credit for. At the beginning of each one, it's kind of traditional that they do this, and it's also a way for it to kind of judge how well you do or not do, and it recommends a difficulty for you. But my point is this, the way those handle it, it doesn't take long, and you're actually doing something. Yeah, it's telling you, click this in the melee, hit this to reload, but the point is at least it doesn't take long, so if you have to do it over and over, if you want to replay the campaign, at least you're not wasting a whole lot of time for it. You might not be able to skip it, but you can at least rush through it. So, I don't know, that's my own personal thing. Unskippable tutorials have always driven me nuts in games, and I still come across it, and I hate it. I always have, and I always will. Give us the option to skip it. Again, thankfully, quite a many games do. And the same goes for cutscenes. Yeah, it's nice the ones that let you skip it right off the bat, or if you, after you see it the first time, you can skip it. But so many games don't let you do that, and especially when you're starting up the game, and you gotta see the people who distributed it, published it, made it. Whatever it is, it gets old quick. You know, it's like, quite a lot of us, me included, I pretty much replay every game I have at least twice, so seeing that over and over and over, and you can't skip through it, it gets kind of annoying and boring, and you're already kind of a little agitated before you even get to playing the game. So, I don't know. That's a personal one for me. For so many years, it's always annoyed me. So, there you go. Anyway, I spent a little too long on that one. All right, this next one. This one I can go even longer on, but I'm going to try not to. And again, this is one I am not alone on, and I can think of quite a few people I talk to quite often about how we hate when we come across this. Second one for me. Games that require an always online connection. Specifically, single-player games that have no rhyme or reason to have this. There is no reason for so many of these single-player games to require you to be always online other than the publisher and or developer is paranoid that they think you're going to do something with it, so they decide to punish everyone equally, including the people who haven't done anything wrong, by doing that. Now you might say, well, what's the big deal? You're probably connected to it online, you're probably connected to the internet all the time anyway, right? To be fair, most of the time, yes, you are. But let's think about it. You're not always, and even then, you don't want to have to have an internet connection, or let's put it this way, you need a stable internet connection, because if it drops out, you can't play it anymore. That's the other problem with this. Again, single-player game. There's no real reason for it, other than that it's a really ridiculous form of DRM. And let's just face it, some of us, we just don't want to have to be forced to be online to play it, okay? While we might always usually have access to the internet, sometimes we don't. What if we went on a trip somewhere, we took our PlayStation 4, Xbox One, or whatever the hell else it is that can connect to the internet with us, and we want to play whatever the frick game it is that requires, that unfortunately that one has always online connection. Say, for example, the newest Need for Speed, which is imaginatively named Need for Speed, they've already come out and said that that one requires always online connection, whether you're playing single player, multiplayer, or whatever. So, think of something like that. There's many other examples, quite a few racing games, actually. Or, here's another kind of case. Say with Test Drive Unlimited 2, here's another racing game I could bring up for an example for another reason why this is a bad thing. If you don't have online or you don't want to use online, literally half the game is inaccessible. And especially when they shut down the servers, which in the case of that game they did, so you literally, no matter what you do, you only have about half of the game, maybe a little less, that you can actually access. So that's a problem too. And here's another problem with this, and I kind of was already alluding to it when I just said that. Some of these ones, again, even if they're a single-player game that require an always online connection, even if you don't ever touch the multiplayer, which there's examples of this, Spore was like that. If you just want to play a single-player, you still had to be connected to online. That was one of the top things people hammered that game for, rightly so, and that's why I still haven't touched it, and never will, personally. They ruined Command & Conquer 3, Tiberium Wars, that way, too. You had to always be online if you just wanted to play single-player skirmish against the bots, or you just want to do the campaign by yourself, you know, because EA deems it. EA is very popular for doing the always online thing. They did it with New SimCity, too. Again, a game that many prefer to play by themselves, offline, you know, they're on a train, whatever else they're doing, they're riding around in the car, they're playing on a laptop. Can't do that because you know, gotta be connected to the internet. Fun, right? So, yeah, it's something that's always annoyed me. I haven't come across a whole ton of games like that, but there's enough where it's disappointed me so much, and it's like crushingly disappointing. I was really interested in this game, I really wanted to play it, and then I see that it's like a stamp of death to a game for me. I won't bother with it. I don't want to touch it because I just know either it's going to get shut down at some point and I won't be able to use it anymore. Well, it's on console or computer, doesn't really matter for that. Or it's going to mess with things. I don't like it. That, and I just don't like supporting that kind of thing personally. That's the other part of it, is I won't get the game because that means I'm supporting that and, you know, telling them it's okay to do. That's a little other part too I'm not going to try to get into, but yeah. Always games that require an always online connection, unless it's an MMO, a massively multiplayer online game, those are the only ones that make sense to have that, where it's a multiplayer only game. That's the only time it legitimately, reasonably makes sense to have a forced and required online, always connected online connection. That's the only time that it makes sense. It really does when you think about it. Single player games should not have that. Or if you want to play the single player component, you should be allowed and able to do that without being connected to the internet. Like I said, this just doesn't annoy me, it annoys others, and yes, again, to be fair, most of the time you are connected to the internet, but that's not really what the problem is here and why we despise it, those of us who do. Again, it's just one of those things. Alright, so that's my second one, and you can see that's the one that pretty much got me the most aggravated, which it does. Yeah, but anyway, okay, so my third one here, and I'm sure many of you can understand why this one annoys me. I've never taken part in it, I don't, it just is one of those things, you see it going on around wherever you're looking at stuff or reading things, or you're around people talking about it and you just groan and roll your eyes. That's the point it's gotten to me with this one, but I've never liked it and it's honestly pointless. The so-called stupid console wars. Arguing and fighting over pieces of entertainment plastic machines that play your discs. Yes, I never understood it. Look, I like the PlayStation 4 more. That's the thing I want. Don't have it yet, but still. I don't have anything personally against the Xbox One. You like the Xbox One, you want to use it, go right ahead. I'm not going to say anything about it. I'm not going to judge you in any certain way like some do, which this is what happens commonly with this console war stuff, where they think just because you prefer or chose to get the Xbox One, you're some kind of dirty cretin. Because you chose that one, and you didn't choose the one that they personally like, so they're gonna work on you for it. It's that kind of stuff. It's very pointless bickering. It sounds like an old married couple arguing. It's annoying. I've never liked it. I've never seen the point in it. It's pointless. Stop wasting time doing that. Just play the damn games and enjoy them and talk about the games themselves. Whatever someone's personal preference is for a console, or this also goes the other way, console versus computer, of course we've all seen this too, which is absolutely ridiculous in itself, just like console versus console, fighting, arguing, bickering, whatever. I don't like it. I've never taken part of it. I never will. It seems very childish to me and very immature, and it's not interesting and it's not fun. You know, if I'm going to talk about something or debate something, it's got to be interesting, and that's not interesting, you know. Throwing insults at each other because you decided to have the audacity to get a certain console over another one just because that's what you chose to do with your money and your personal preference, and it has the kind of exclusives you want, you like its controller, whatever it is, that's your choice. No one else has any right to tell you. It's not their money, it's not their choice. They can voice, this is the whole thing again, subjective versus objective. There's objective things, and then there's subjective things. Subjective things is, I chose to get this console because that's the one I like. I like talking about the Genesis Mega Drive more than Super Town. Doesn't mean I don't like that any less, but I prefer to talk about that more. Doesn't mean I think one is better than the other. It's just what I prefer. It's kind of like that. I like both. Here's a personal example. Let me bring it back to me. Personal example. I, at one point, had the Wii, the Xbox 360, and the PlayStation 3 at the same time. I really like the Xbox 360. I do. I really like the PlayStation 3. But when push comes to shove, I do prefer the PlayStation 3. That is just my personal preference. It always has been, always will be, because certain exclusives on it, I like its controller better, yada yada yada, certain other aspects. That's just my personal preference. An example I'm saying here, to make more sense. I came across many people, they did not have a PlayStation 3, never wanted one, didn't care for it, some of them downright despised it. But so long as they just kept that to their, and you know, they didn't try to work me over for anything, I was fine with it. You don't have to like it just because I do, that's fine. That's the easy, and that's the adult thing to do. Again, it all comes back to, it's your money, spend on what you want, who cares what anyone else thinks. If you like the Xbox One, you love the damn thing, and that's what you want, and you would never care for and don't want to touch the Wii U or the PlayStation 4, that's fine. But the whole arguing thing is really old. I mean, and just to mention this, I've noticed this kind of slowed down and not as vehemently common as it was even like 2 or 3 years ago. But it's still around, and it still is kind of aggravating. It's just the whole fanboyism thing. So technically, I guess what this really is, what I'm getting at is for my number 3, could either be called console war, arguing, bickering, and or fanboyism, which I don't like that either, by the way. I really don't. It's insufferable to listen to and say, I don't do that, I never have, and I won't. Maybe it's I don't get it, I don't see any fun in it or any appeal to it, and it just is off-putting to me. And I don't know. Personally, I've always found it kind of annoying. That's basically my whole thing. I don't like it. I don't like the console war thing or the whole fanboy thing, which does play a part in that, a huge part, and that is pretty much the prime thing fueling it. So, there you go. I mean, the companies like it. They know it goes on. They kind of fuel the fire, too, but that's just the way it is. It drums up business. So, I guess it does have some kind of purpose, but I don't like it. It's just a little too goofy for me. Just get whatever one you want. And go with that. Don't belittle someone else because they chose a certain piece of plastic to play their entertainment software on. I don't get it. Now, if you want to debate actual things that are wrong with one or the other, or one does something better than the other, like one's got a faster processor or whatever, that actually has some kind of basis, and at least to me, that kind of makes sense. But the whole rest of it, the way it goes, I'm sure you know what I mean. It went on back in the Super Nintendo Genesis Mega Drive days, which is kind of why I mentioned this. I didn't like it then either. I didn't like it then, and I don't like it now. Then it was a little bit more funny, I think. It was a little less, angry than it is now, if that makes sense. It wasn't as personal, but, yeah, I never liked it much at all. Okay, so my fourth and final one, because this is going on way too long. Sorry about that. Like I said, sometimes when this stuff gets you worked up, you keep going on it because you're passionate about it. Which, that's why I like this topic. Anyway, the last one, and this one, again, is one of those kind of things, unless you play games on the computer, you probably won't be able to understand it as much. but I do, even though I try not to as much as I used to, but it's still kind of thing. This has improved slightly, but not nearly enough, honestly. And, well, even if you don't play games on the computer, I'm sure you might be able to understand this. Botched console ports on the PC, on the computer. Now, there's plenty of examples of this. I can go old, I can go new, I can go very recent. Case in point, Batman Arkham Knight. Holy, holy moly, everything. This was one of the worst releases I can remember that has come out on the computer, and they didn't even try. Console versions worked fine. Then the computer version came out from day one, and it still has plenty of problems. They patched it. It's like trying to plug a boat with all your fingers and the holes in the deck, and you're going to run out of fingers. There's so much wrong with that. And it's like a widespread problem, so it wasn't just a few people isolated having it. Oh no, it was a big thing. And even worse, some people were doing fine than others. And because there's all different kinds of hardware setups, you know, the floodgates open and all kinds of mess, and there's plenty of videos out there showing exactly what goes wrong with it. But that's just one example. Mortal Kombat X, another recent one, that was an atrocious console port on the computer, too. It's a very long-running problem that has plagued games on PC. Again, to be fair, not all are like this. Some actually do put the effort in, and they do make a proper console port. Again, bringing this up, the Mad Max game. It works great on the computer. Next to no issues of any kind when it comes to performance. Anything that is there is very minor and has been fixed. In fact, there was a nice patch that came out today and fixed quite a few things. You know, some of them do care and do actually put the effort in because they realize, you know what, we should actually make it work on PC. But then you got so many of these others where they just don't. Either they can't be bothered to do things properly for the keyboard and mouse, whereas rebinding it or anything like that. No proper FOV options. Or even if you can't mess around with it in the INI files and go digging around. You shouldn't have to go screwing around in the game's actual files to change that stuff. It should be in the damn menu. It's standardized stuff that needs to be in a computer game. Proper graphics options. Some games, I can name a lot, have the audacity to think that you don't have the right or incapable of deciding what you need to choose to make it run on your particular computer. Which is ridiculous. Even just something as basic as separate volume sliders for music, sound effects, and voice volume. Oh, why would you need that? Because, you know, let's just drown out what they're trying to say and you can't hear it and you have to turn subtitles on just so you know what the hell they're saying. And because you can't change how much overpowering the music is for sound effects. You know, basic stuff like that. I mean, come on. And then you also have the biggest problem, which is the performance thing, which I've already mentioned. You know, it's horrible controls. They didn't work correctly for the keyboard and mouse or whatever. Any if you use controller, sometimes that doesn't help. Absolutely abysmal performance problems, so on. It's the typical console port BS. Again, that's slightly improved over time, but we still get far too many that just are not, honestly, as the term is, fit for purpose on the computer, which is very disappointing, especially when they don't give us demos for most of the stuff and they expect us to pay console price for a computer game, which many of us know better than we're not used to that, so we don't like it. On top of that, when you can't even be bothered to make a proper PC version, we're not asking for a lot, just make it work the way it's supposed to, like it should. It's not that hard. We will tell you, and we do tell you, when they mess up. Oh yes, just like, again, Batman Arkham Knight and the massive amount of outcry for that, as was rightly so. Just like Mortal Kombat X and many other examples of that. And then there are some, by the way, I just want to throw this one last thing in, that never get fixed. And even down the modders, sometimes they can't even fix the problems, which is sad, but that's the way it goes. So yeah, some of us are willing to deal with it and try to fix problems on our own and hope things get fixed. Sometimes they do, so I give credit to the ones that do, but a lot of times they don't and we just get horrible console ports. Having played on the computer for so long like I have and still do to a degree now with newer stuff, yeah, it's one of the top things that's annoying. It really is. Specifically playing games on the computer. Fortunately, it's not every game like that, so, you know, I want to make it clear, not every console port works that way, so, thankfully. Anyway, but there you go. This is pretty long, but those are my four answers for this Friday Foursome number 10, most irritating aspects of gaming. My personal choices, anyway. Anyway, again, I have a link down below to Novabug so you can check out his channel as well as his original video, and I definitely recommend you check him out because he does a lot of cool stuff. Anyway, so that's it. Thank you for watching and listening, and I will see you later.